Hi, everybody. I'm Karen Schaler, and welcome to Christmas Karen Behind the Story. So excited to have you, because what we're going to be doing during this show, we decided to take you behind the scenes of those movies you love, the Hallmark, Lifetime, Netflix Christmas movies. And I'm going to share some of my stories and also talking about Christmas novels, of course. But I thought the best way to really take you behind the scenes is talk to some of the top players that I've been really blessed to be connected with, everybody from writers and directors and actors and experts, agents, you name it, because I really wanted the show to be your show. I think during this time, more than ever, we all need to have something inspiring and empowering, a way to reach out and connect. And what better way than to share some of the things I've learned and some of these amazing people that have agreed to come on and give some tips. So if you're interested in writing or directing, becoming an agent, you know, any of the above, working as an author, trying to finish that first big novel, we're going to bring you the people that have fun stories, but they're also going to give back and give you tips. And I couldn't be more excited. And I mean, really like fangirl excited, because joining me now is Jeff Fisher. He is the director of my very first Hallmark movie, Christmas Camp, but he's not just a director. I mean, I need a whole show to tell you all that he's doing, so we're going to get into that, but he's a writer. That's so important, right? We're creative. It starts with a story, and his passion is writing and directing and producing and story. I mean, everything. And so, Jeff, thank you. Yay. Happy Christmas. Happy holidays.
Hi, Karen. Happy Christmas. Thank you so much for having me. It's great to virtually meet you in person, finally.
Yeah. I know. You know what's so crazy about this is we did a movie together, but that's what we're going to explain to people. People don't really know how it works when you're a writer and what happens. But the short version that I'll tell people is I always say that if the story starts in my head and I create this magic, then the magic is a huge collaboration and the new boss becomes the director. So Jeff then took my story and he is the one that made all those words come to life with the help of the team. So let's just jump right into Christmas Camp because we have a lot to talk about. But tell me about that project when you got the script and you have to decide. People don't also realize. Sometimes people think, oh, a director's hired and then they find out. No, it's your choice because it has to be your passion. So please tell us about that.
Sure. I was psyched to get your great script, Karen. I had done another Hallmark Christmas movie the previous holiday with the same production company and with Hallmark, and your title and idea was just such it was so winning, you know. So it was really exciting to get the script, and I think you probably shared with some of your viewers before. It happens pretty quickly, right? So it usually happens over the summer, right? So then you've got to start thinking, how do I make this look and feel like Christmas, and how do I also get it done in time for Christmas? So you know what? Once I got the script, it started moving quickly. We were shooting, I'd say, within six or eight weeks for sure. Yeah. So.
And Bas, I want you to share more on that. People were blown away because we always hear those stories of feature films of how it takes 10 years and how it'll take 2 years to shoot one of these epics. People are stunned when I tell them, and you can speak to it as well, that some of these movies, a lot of them, especially Hallmark Lifetime, maybe 16 days. Or tell me about that once you even, and we're talking the shoot. Yeah, just from the time boots on the ground.
Well, I shot a Lifetime movie in 12 days.
No! That's a record.
We had 15 for, we had 15 for Christmas Camp. And it was extremely kind of you to say that the director is the boss once the writer turns over the script. I think we both know the production company.
Okay. Maybe the owner is the boss.
Has an opinion or two. But certainly I try to take your great idea, and you know, we start bringing it to life by casting Hallmark, which a terrific characteristic is that they're, you know, super passionate about the, certainly the leads, you know, and the cast. So kind of that, once the ball starts rolling, you really start, locking down in this case, who is going to be, who is going to be our Haley, right? And kind of build around that. And, it was a great piece of serendipity, because, because Lillianne, who was just, I can't say enough great things about her. She was just such
she was an amazing Haley, yeah. Haley. I was when I saw her. She was amazing. Yeah.
She's just lovely inside and out. But I had been lucky enough to work with, you know, her dad is been an actor who I you know, grew up watching, Gregory Harrison. And Gregory Harrison was actually the father in the previous Hallmark movie that I had. So it was wild, right, to go over. And I remember Greg, when we were shooting the finale of My Christmas Love, I played music in the background. I knew we wouldn't be able to afford it. I think I played Michael Bublé's cover of The Way You Look Tonight. And he said, I just danced to this at my daughter's wedding. This is surreal. So he had just danced to it at Lillianne's sister's wedding. But anyway, it was very all in the family. So that was a nice little...
And let's talk about that, because if the fans of Hallmark that are watching, it's no secret, and it's one of the brilliance of the Hallmark brand, that they have these amazing characters that we all connect with. You know, we can name them all at the top of our head. Even people that don't watch Hallmark movies will go, oh, you know, Lacey Chabert, or, you know, all these stars that they love. You know, right. Rachel Boston, we love her. And I think that's part of the brand. And as a director, and when I mean, obviously, you take over creatively and don't do yourself an injustice, because I've learned as a writer, and this is why I also am an author. As a writer, I create this vision, and then a director takes that vision. And of course, the production company is the one, it's their brand that you are hired because of, you fit that brand, and they have things you need to tick off. But you have to bring the story to life, whether it's casting, actors. You're actually like almost probably a life coach sometime, which I talk to directors who say, you know, you have to deal with talent, right? You have to bring out the best of them. You're not just dealing with the director and lighting, and you're not just dealing with this. You are the ringleader of what, you know, I love joking, the Christmas circus sometimes. And I love that insider story, but we tend to see the same people or the same settings on Hallmark. Is that just because they're beloved, or also because Hallmark shoots 40 movies sometimes at Christmas?
Sure, they shoot a lot. Well, I mean, you know, Lillianne was really just starting out her acting career a bit. So I think this was her first lead, right?
Yeah.
Her first feature, and she really had to, you know, carry it. And you know, we chatted, you know, before we met. We shot on location in upstate New York, and I talked to her and I had watched some of her work, but, you know, she just really was, she was lovely. And having not been, you know, I'm sorry, you referenced like Lacey Chabert or so many of the other great actors on there. Well, but they've been to the rodeo before, right? This was brand new for Lillianne. So I really wanted to make sure that, you know, we created an environment where she felt safe and supportive, right? Mm-hmm. I don't think, especially when you're making a romantic comedy, you know, or a movie about people falling in love, boy, you don't want the set to be super unpleasant, right?
Because no. We need Christmas like this. We need cheer and joy. And then we should talk about Bobby too, because he is a little bit of a veteran of these Hallmark movies, right?
Yes. And you had previously named Bobby Jeff, right? And I think everybody thought that I like changed Bobby's character's name to be my name. But I love Bobby. He's a talented guy, and we had worked together on the same movie that I just referenced with Greg, My Christmas Love. I just think he's really like subtle, terrific actor, and you know, and you know, they were all great collaborators. I think the next person that came on, who I know you've connected with, well, I know she adores you, is Geraldine Lear, who had
Heart.
Right, she had come in, and she had just shot the pilot for
Manifest.
Right, yes. So, you know, she came in, she was great. I loved, you know, when she came in for the audition, she you know, she was referencing that, you know, she's like, you might remember me. I was the girl who Julia Roberts stole my boyfriend in Mystic Pizza.
In Mystic Pizza, right. Which is such a classic line.
Yeah.
Well, so it's so fun how we connected Dale, the character at Christmas Camp. And it's hard to say because they're all my favorites, truly. You know, different, like Ben, you know, and for the viewers and listeners, you know, Christmas Camp. But Gail was such an amazing character. And when she reached out to me and said that she had taken a little break from acting, you know, she had this amazing career, and that she really wanted to come back with a role that spoke to her and that my words spoke to her. I think, I mean, that just gave me chills now. No kidding. I wish you could see, because as a writer, that's what you want to do. You want to tell a story that connects. And I wanted to make all my characters that way. And we were so fortunate that we got to meet in New York. And she actually is going to be on the show too, coming up. I can't say too much. I can't leak, but she's shooting a movie. I can't say what, where, why, but she has to go and prepare for that movie. So she's there now, and she was going, you know, do this. So she's going to be on remote and seeing if we can really get behind the scenes with her. But she is just a light, and all of the cast, all of the cast. I mean, I just was so excited. And the crazy part that a lot of people don't know, and I know it was a surprise, and there's so much more to talk about, so I won't keep talking about our movie together that, of course, is so passionate. Mm-hmm. But when it was slated to come out that year, and that's how I became an author, and that's why I was explaining the connection of a director. So I'm a writer, screenwriter. I had just broken in with A Christmas Prince that I had actually written that was slated in what the plan was for Hallmark, you know, the royal, that was the idea. Yeah. And then it ends up on Netflix as their first Christmas movie, and went a little bonkers.
Such a huge hit for them. My gosh.
Yeah. And it's, I really believe, I've been wanting to write romantic comedy for 10 years. You know, my icons, you know, that's what they wrote, and romantic comedy sort of disappeared. So to have that go there, and it's young audience, I love the feedback, because there's this young audience on Netflix that do not traditionally watch the Lifetime Hallmark Christmas movies, but they're like, what is this cheesy, crazy, silly little silly movie? But I love it. And they even came over, right, to the Hallmark, and you go, wait, there's more of these out there? Where do I find these? And it really opened up the romantic comedy. So Christmas Camp, that came out in November, and I got the call about Christmas Camp in end of January. And there's an ironic story, you know, about that as well, where I was at the Phoenician in Scottsdale, Arizona, talking about how I wanted to bring Christmas Camp to life for real. And well, whatever happened to that movie? Oh, I don't know. You know, I'm hoping, fingers crossed, it's in the works. I mean, it's in consideration, but you never know. I said that at the Phoenician about how I wanted to bring it to life. I went down to get in my car, and I got the call that it had sold to Hallmark. And while I was there, and as we know, I then did bring Christmas Camp to life at the Phoenician. And it was very full circle. So that's that story. So after I knew it went into development, which was very fast, got notes, you know, and I'll talk about that and some other of these so we can get back to, but I knew you guys were shooting like lightning. But right as soon as it took over, because this was like one of my, you know, these are spec scripts, I already had a sequel, and there was talk about, you know, potentially doing that. So I was like, it was hard as a writer when you're a newbie to realize, oh, I'm done. Because writers don't generally get to go on set for a lot of reasons, sometimes because it's rock and roll and super fast. But I had handed it over to the next team that was going to make it magical. That's when I said, I have more to say. Shocker. I'm going to write the book. And so that's how, and you know, I'll talk about that, but writing Christmas Camp and Christmas Camp Wedding and having them come out at the same time was the plan. But then Christmas Camp didn't come out when we thought it was. You know, we never know. Those are way powers above us, right? We're creatives. But then I actually, when it came out for the first time, I saw it in a theater in Toronto. So I saw our Christmas movie that I was waiting to be on TV the first time in that limited release in Toronto and seeing it. And let me tell you, Jeff, that buying a ticket, eating popcorn, sitting in the theater, that was a magical moment. So I want to thank you for being part of that, because I just think what you do, and that segues me into your first Hallmark movie, because that is one of my favorites. And I know it's one of the highest rated that Hallmarks have. So tell me how that came about. Was that your first, your very first?
And Karen, yes, and I want to jump into that, but I just have to give you, you know, mad props or whatever the 2020 version of huge compliments. You know, Karen, you have just an amazing ability, you know, to come up, your ideas are just like home runs, you know, with like A Christmas Prince and Christmas Camp, just really kind of like typing into the zeitgeist of what people want to see and what people need, right? There's just so much bad news out there. Like, just pumping like some good into the world is so important. And you've just got, you know, an amazing knack from it. And just your sunny disposition, right? Just like keeping it up there and helping to spread the word. I just continually impressed by, you know,
I can only do it with people like you, honestly. Yeah. I mean, that's the thing. I wish now in college, I maybe think I could have been a director. Maybe I could have been, actually, you know what I wanted to be? When I got to go on the Toni Braxton set and nobody knew who I was. So I'm kind of little, the first day I'm off to the side and I heard the props guy, you'll appreciate this. He goes, who the heck decided LED angels, 4-foot angels? We can't get any LED angels. And what's this Christmas sparkle heart thing? How am I supposed to find one of those? And I just go, Amazon, you have that in Canada, right? I said, cause that's where I got the idea for the angels. And they go, and they look over at me and go, you're the writer. And it was that moment because I realized what I make up in my head, there's actually a job that has to find it.
Yeah.
Remember, our little elf in Christmas camp? Of course, what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Our production designer was looking all over for our little friend there.
And I think that's what I love sharing the inside behind the scene with people, because people don't realize that I didn't, as a writer, I might create something in my head, but somebody actually is going to find that or make a rendition or something out of that. But what was it like? That was my first Hallmark movie. What was your first Christmas Hallmark movie like for you?
Sure. Well, you know, Karen, like you, like I love romantic comedies. Like I grew up just, you know, I love Goldie Hawn and I love, they're just a genre that I love. So ironically, my, you know, two short films when I was like, you know, I was working at a talent agency, yeah. You know, answering phones, trying to like make movies out of the, you know, on my, you know, week off as an assistant, but I made a 30-minute romantic comedy and I made a 15-minute musical romantic comedy. But to make a really long story short, the jobs I ended up getting, I lucked out and they did pretty well at the film festivals and stuff. But the job I got out of it was directing reality television, right? Which was on the agenda. So like doing early stuff like that, you know, like Real World and you know, Simple Life and
Don't do that. Those are iconic things, Jeff. The fact that you were on those, that is huge. That was the precursor of what we have now. So props to you for being in on the ground level, even though you didn't plan it.
Okay. Well, thank you. Well, it got to be, and I loved, you know, those really early things. Believe me, Paris and Nicole, I could, you know, watch them walk around a parking lot. And I believe I did. Do exactly that.
I think you did.
But you know, it got to a point where reality TV got a little bit more argumentative, right?
Yeah.
Like it was
controversial.
And it just felt I was just it, you know, it was I was super grateful for it. And you know, at another time we can talk about, you know, the significant learnings and kind of story and structure that, you know, shooting something, shooting 100 hours of something and being like, okay, I have to make a half hour TV. Mm-hmm. What eight scenes make my A story? What 4 scenes make up my B story? And how the heck do we put this together? It definitely made me kind of economical as a writer, I hope, or as a, you know, to try to tell stories. But anyway, so I finally, I'm like, wow, I have to like, and I was really trying to convince people that the skill set that I had from the shorts and reality TV would transfer into, you know, into scripted fare. Just wasn't having a lot of luck there. I shadowed, like, we can talk about what shadowing is.
Yeah.
A lot of that. So I'm like, well, I just have to raise money and make my first feature. And I'm sorry, I'm getting to the rom-com.
This is casual. There's no time. Right. That's what's beautiful about what we do. We get to talk as long as it's interesting.
Okay. Yeah, sounds good. So I'm like, well, you know what? I've got to write a movie. Now at the time, even though I was like desperate to make a feature rom-com, right? Because that would have been the next step after my shorts. This was like 2007. And Karen, like I tell you, like, and I was wishing instead of going to film school that I got my MBA, right? Because suddenly I had to raise a couple million bucks to shoot a feature. And I'm like pitching to guys that are like in, you know, the boiler room of Morgan Stanley, you know, and the movies that were just making enormous money at that point, they were remaking like Friday the 13th and Halloween and the Saw movies were doing so great.
Yep.
So these horror movies would have like these $40 million opening weekends. I'm like, okay, well, what if I, and I just had a crazy reality TV job. Just, it was like this crazy job that we shot in the middle of a winter in Michigan. And I was like, oh yeah. So I came home and wrote and I was working on a show with Jennifer Lopez called DanceLife. And I got up, and I'm like, I have to do this. I got up at 4 a.m. every morning, what the writing.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm running.
Gotta make the time.
Yeah, I'm running for 2 hours. I'm like, if I don't do this, I'm never gonna, move the needle. So anyway, make a really long story short, I ended up writing my first movie, which was about a reality TV show in all kinds of trouble, right? And it was like, I wanted to make it like a comedy horror movie. So shot that, we got into Tribeca, and then, 2008 was about as much fun to sell a movie as it was to sell a condo, not fun, right?
Not good.
So off that, I ended up getting more thrillers, right? I'm like, they're like, oh, this guy can make, thrillers. I'm like, okay. So I'm like, I'm grateful for the work. So when I finally, the Mar Vista, the production company I had done the thriller with, they had a relationship with Hallmark, and that's how my Christmas Love, the first one that I did, came in. And, I read the script, and I loved the script. The writers, like you, just did a fantastic job. Then it comes to, I'm like, okay, well, I want to make basically something that looks like a Nancy Meyers movie for
this much money.
On Christmas Camp, it was much less.
Okay, I know. We can talk about that.
But I'm like, okay, well, but you know what? If you have a team, like the team on My Christmas Love, they were just kind of like in it to win it. Like, okay, well, we know we can, let's just figure it out. We know that we're shooting in the summer. We know that, we've got X, Y, and Z. And to me, it's just the actors are so important. I really feel like when you get into the rom-com world, people are going to you can have the best script in the world, the best script in the world. But, I find that people are going to like a romantic comedy in close proportion to how much they like the leads, right?
Absolutely. And the chemistry, has to be there. So, you can write the chemistry, and you just pray that the casting director has so much power too. And the, all of you that pick the leads, because that's what I fall in love with, even on my own movies, I watch for that chemistry.
Sure. No, it is. And I'm just a strong believer. I'm like, you're going to like, while you were sleeping in direct proportion to how much you like Sandra Bullock and Bill Pullman, which is a lot, right? So we really get into the casting, and then, and Karen, I'm sure as you know, it's like the little parts are super important also, right?
Absolutely. 100%.
Not the little parts. There are no.
Yeah. No, parts. No. But in terms of storylines, like some people don't realize you might have, and I never knew this, Jeff, and like talking about kind of the behind the story, how actors count lines and agents count lines. Mm-hmm. So all of a sudden when you're doing parts, they're like, well, my talent needs at least 54 lines. And I actually, on one of my movies for Equity, which I'm all for, and it wasn't the same word of equity that we're using today, but had to do the same lines for union rules to make sure this person has this many lines, so we need this many lines. So I had to change my script for lines. And these are things that people have, no idea behind the scenes. But one of the things I noticed, and I'd love for you to talk about even on this first movie, I didn't realize the director was such a therapist. I just think it's fascinating. And maybe you don't have that role, but what I saw, not only was the director phenomenal, just putting things together, but he was also like going over and talking to the actor, going, here's how I'm doing. What about when you were little? Think about what that felt like. And was giving that, I guess, direction. So do you do that? Or tell us what that is. Because I thought it was really beautiful, to be honest with you. It was such a connection between the director and the actor. Like, trust was there.
Sure. Yeah. Well, speaking, I think actors have I have so much respect for them, and they have such a difficult job, right? To just, first of all, to like go sit in a waiting room with 40 people that look like you for the same part, go in and, I have a feeling that, I want to make that audition, a warm, welcoming space. And I know you would too, but it's not always the case, right? Sometimes they're walking into a room that's not that warm, right? And they're just, and then suddenly 2 days later, it's like, okay, well, fly to Utah. It's 95 degrees later, put on a down coat, right? And there's all these people on set, and come hit your mark and act like you're in love. It's like, oh, okay. So you really do want to, create an environment that makes them feel comfortable to do their best work. But, Karen, all we can, we can draw on when we're communicating that to people is what our life experiences are, right? So it's like, you know, I could say, for me, I love movies, and I'm sure, you know, you do as well. But so I've got way too many movie references, right? Like, I remember, like, sitting with Kaley Cuoco and asking her to watch a scene from The Poseidon Adventure with me, so I could, you know, show her
how Melissa
Martin crawl through a tunnel. But, you know, I mean, I think with Meredith, with Lily, with all of the, you know, great actors, there were moments, right? Like for that, if we wanted, you know, an opening sequence to like feel like kind of like the Devil Wears Prada, right? Maybe whatever the language was, because it's impossible for anybody to know what's going on in my head, right? So right. I've got to get the most tangible references, be it a Pinterest board, be it a clip from a movie, right? Let's try to reimagine this, right? So it's that collaboration. And you know, if you're lucky, then the actor's like, oh yeah, I love that, like I'm into it to win it. And if they're not, then it's like, okay, well let's rethink it, right? Like let's figure out
That's what I think that's fascinating, because I don't think people have any, you know, you think you do a job, but that love on a set, especially on our Christmas movies for our Hallmark and, you know, Lifetime and Netflix. And I want, you touched on something that I know if I don't ask, every fan asks me this. They think that we shoot more than a year ahead, that we wait till winter and we shoot our Christmas in the winter and then they air next year. And I'm like, no, Christmas camp, talk about, I know it was July, upstate New York, and it was like in the 90s, and I have a snowball fight. So how do you recreate winter, and how often do you see that happening? You know, in general, you know, with I can speak on Hallmark, Lifetime specifically. Sure. I know mine were all shot in the summer.
Well, first of all, I'll say happily, look, Hallmark, Lifetime, it's okay. You can send me to
exactly.
You can send me on a jungle cruise. I'll shoot you a holiday movie, whatever. I'll find the snow. Look, it's a big education, you know, it's what different types of snow, what can we afford? What are the different types of snow?
And what are they? Wait, I have to ask, what do you mean different types for us laymen? What are we seeing when we watch those movies?
So, I mean, I think the foam that we ended up using the most, the consistency, I think would be, you know, the way it comes out, it would be most similar to what you would imagine coming out of a fire extinguisher, right?
Okay.
It's foam and it's got a very quick melt shelf life, right?
Oh,
so
yeah.
You've got to you can get through about one take, right, with it looking good. So I don't know if I should be telling all our secrets.
Yeah, no, it's good. But, hey, this is what the show is for. We want secrets.
Sure. So there's a base that's basically called a snow blanket, right?
Yeah.
And that would be kind of almost like a gauzy, textured, piece
of kind of like a blanket,
a blanket,
so it lays down,
that's going to be your base, right? So that's going to hopefully cover the greenery on the floor, cover some of the stuff. But I mean, it would look like a piece of gauze, right? So
right,
then, but
right.
It's going to take the most of the green out, and then you also have to make sure that the grass is protected, right, from whatever the whatever's going on top of it, so the grass stays healthy after that. Then you're blowing this foam. Look, if you have, you know, if you're making like the sequel to Elf, and you have video budget, then you could actually have an ice machine.
Real snow.
That blows it out, which is great.
I think that's what I love about what you have to do, because I think that makes us more creative when we work on these lower budget movies. And it's out there in the press. People know that anywhere from $1 million to the average $1.5 million, you know, if you're getting an extra one, maybe $3 million if it's one of the showcase. And people are blown away by that, and also the short amount of time. And Christmas Camp, I know, for you know, a lot of different reasons, you know, there's budgets, was done on a very, 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 very tight budget. And I am so impressed with what you all were able to do. I always joke when I write, I always say Christmas is a character. And if you have to have an extra or extra Christmas lights, the extra goes, meaning a person, because Christmas wins. There has to be Christmas lights. So I'm obsessed with Christmas lights in all my movies and all my books. It's over the top Christmas. Yeah. Like Finding Christmas is my book that came out after Christmas Camp, is she's obsessed. And people are like, she's a little obsessed. I'm like, yes, she is. But I think that's what you do. And you take all of this magic and you're able to put it together. But what I really want to get to too as well is getting to your tips, because I know people are dying to hear like maybe how to break in and that. But I wanted to ask you three quick questions, kind of like one of those speed dating. I just made this up, by the way, because I have no notes, as you can see, because I'm standing in my Christmas village. So I am in shooting this right now.
I want to go there. Yes.
You want to. That's the plan. I am in Scottsdale, Arizona. It's 105. So I am celebrating Christmas. I immerse myself. But real quick, and I'm kind of making this up off the top of my head, and it can be, the answer doesn't have to be quick, but tell me, while shooting a Christmas movie, any of the Christmas movie, like a really funny moment, like one of these moments, maybe something that went crazy. What comes to mind?
Oh my.
I know, just pick one. He's like, do you got another show?
Okay, sure. Okay, well.
Come on. Oh, okay,
yeah,
share.
Sure. So my Christmas love, so I like movie musicals. I like old musicals, yeah. Right? So on my Christmas love, the movie revolved around the 12 day a secret admirer sending the 12 days of Christmas as live action. And I'm like, but you know, for budgetary reasons, all those people, all 12 days had to be there the same day in costume, right? We had to bang out all the 12 days of Christmas, and then they're supposed to stand on the lawn on the 12th day. I'm like, if these people are showing, if we're having 60 extras in costume, I'm like, they're singing and dancing, right? I'm like, I'm sorry. I'm like, well, we have to have them go. So, I talked to Larry, who is our awesome producer, and he's like, look, man, if you could shoot the musical number and still make your day and shoot it safe, right? Like the way, the network wants, we can do it. I'm like, okay. So there was this amazing choreographer. She happened to be in Utah, but she was just a wonderful lady named Bonnie Story, who she was from Utah, but she'd done tons of stuff in LA and New York, and was, you know, a superstar. So we put together like these people and Kensers. We did a quick, cheap, like pre-record of this wonderful lady that could sing the 12 days of Christmas, and just put together this musical number, and just thought really quick, okay, well, how are we going to cover this? How are we going to, you know, make it look good? So I mean, that was like
cool.
It was, I'm so happy that it wound up in the movie, because
I can't believe you did it with the budget and the time, because I've been on these sets. I was really lucky. I got to take my mom on the set of the Toni Braxton Lifetime movie, and Every Day is Christmas. And I'll talk about that, you know, in other shows coming up. Yeah. My mom was like, you guys move. I mean, from craft services for the people behind the scene, that's that come on set and make sure people have food and nutritious and not nutritious. I totally went for the junk food. It works for me. But really impressive. It was impressive. So when people say low budget, I think there are so much talent there, opposed to sometimes the feature film. Of course, everyone's talented, but to do what is done quickly like that, and for you to be able to say, let's give it a girl. I know we have a budget. I know this is impossible, but that's why you make good movies, Jeff. Why you make magic.
Thanks. And listen, I am so grateful to every member of the crew, from our production designer who had to, you know, make it to the snow machine, to our, you know, our great DP. It was a group effort, to all those terrific actors and background artists.
That's what's key. And I think that makes it, when people watch it, you kind of feel the love, because you either get it or you don't, you know. And I think that's why Hallmark hits it out of the park. Lifetime, Netflix jumping into this too, is so exciting. So for people watching, I asked you ahead of time to give me some tips so I could specifically ask you, and to people watching, and I think there's so many people, and you do every job, so it's not like you want to be an author or a screenwriter. I love that you're a writer and a director and producer and a store. I say story director, but that's not the right, the right terminology. And you also teach and give back what your knowledge is. So all of that just shows you're well-rounded in this creative. So that said,
most importantly,
there he is. I was just going to say, he's there. We have to stop the press because, this is not even, I wish I had my book where I can show you, but I know we'll put it up on the screen. Hi, Dash. That's so when you got Dash, and I saw you posted him, my dog in my last book is named Dasher.
Okay.
So I wonder, they should be friends. Wait, hold Dash up, and I'm going to hold Dasher up. We'll put it in post. So, come here, Dashy. Oh, he's so cute. Okay, perfect. You hold him right there, and I'm going to see. We'll see what our producer Denise can do. We can work magic. Oh, he's so sleepy. And yeah, was he inspiration? Is he going to be in one of our movies?
Yeah, heck yes. I would love it. Well, I wanted to get a Jack Russell Terrier. There was Dash's predecessor was named Chase, and he was in Chase's alt ego was in Killer Movie. But yes, I would love to keep Dash.
He's a doll. Great. Oh my gosh, we're gonna have, and he has an Instagram. Wait, what is his Instagram?
Dash is your buddy. That's what I came out of COVID with. Dash is Instagram page.
I know, you know what? And people will connect because we're going to get Dash lots of followers. Everyone follow Dash if you want to be happy, because that just makes me happy. And we got Jeff behind the scenes here. So when you were talking about tips, I'm kind of mixing them up for you, but one of the ones I like that really resonated with me is that it's a lot harder than you think it's going to be. Like, we all go in going, we know it's impossible. It's really a competitive business. Yada, yada, yada. But we all think if we work really hard at this and we give it 100%, and I have my own story, but I want to hear from you, not only how hard it is, but what tip you would give to someone to keep going during that hardship.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, Karen, there was nothing else that I wanted to do. Right. And I knew, like, since I was a little kid, I wanted to do it. I went to, film school and, whatever. I mean, like, my short films in film school, like, won student awards. I'm like, oh boy, yeah. I'm going to get out to Hollywood. They've been waiting.
Right? They've been waiting for you.
And then an unbelievable stroke of luck, I ended up, like, one of my first gigs, like, first big gigs was on a Scorsese movie, right? And so this was before I moved to LA. I'm like, well, I just got off a Scorsese flick. No. They're definitely going to want to hire me, right? Like, a month after, like, Pound the Pavement, I'm folding shirts at Banana Republic being like, I don't know. I think I mentioned that, like, I was working at a talent agency. I had started seeing that people that had had continued success in the career, in their careers there, all seemed to have that in common. They spent some time working at a talent agency, but I was like pushing a mail cart. And the guy to the left of me went to Harvard Law School. The guy to the right went to Yale. I'm like, if you think that they didn't deliver like the sexiest, schmooziest, best dressed male you've ever seen, it's just, everybody is so, driven, right? And talented it is. But so you really have to, like, just give it your best. And unfortunately, the effort you put in doesn't always, it doesn't always yield the results you want. It doesn't yield it on your timeline, right? It's not there. Mm-hmm. So
did you ever have a plan B? See, I never had a plan B. That helped me. So if you don't have a plan B, you got to make it work. You got to figure it out. I mean, I'm not saying I wasn't, waitressing, doing what you need to do to make plan A work. Because that's a firm believer in go after your dream, but be willing to do the work.
Sure. I didn't. I looked deep for it. And I waited tables all through college, through film school. I could, try to wait tables in LA, which, trying to get a waiting room job in LA, I don't know how successful I would have been, but I'd rather work in, I learned so much as a production assistant, and I learned so much, on these different set jobs. So I just wanted to get that under my belt. What I would say to people is, like, look, and like my first, you mentioned craft service. My first job that I broke in with, I was fourth assistant in the craft service department.
I didn't know that.
Literally chicking up, sweeping up the chicken bones from the background artists, like, lunch at the Miami Seaquarium. But I was so happy to be on set. I was like, the best chicken bone sweeper. But look, people are going to ask you to do some, not glamorous jobs. They're super long days. If you just do the best job that you possibly can, whatever it is, somebody is going to notice, right? And if they don't notice, they will notice on the next job. And you don't want to be with those people that aren't noticing that you're putting all your hard work and effort into it. So, I mean, you got to just, you got to just keep it up. And I guess don't worry about the mistakes that you make, right?
Yeah. Look, that was your next one about mistakes. I've learned the most from my mistakes.
Yeah. I'm always, it's so easy to Monday morning quarterback. And what if I would have done this? And what if I wouldn't have done that? Okay, well, yeah, sure. I would have liked to have known that. But okay, here, I've got a quick example for you. So
yeah.
That first garage sale was that first 30-minute romantic comedy that I made. And I stuck it all on my credit cards. I was making like $250 a week as an agent's assistant, you know, and just getting.
And we should explain $250 as in $250.
$250. $250 a week. You're like $201.48 after.
Yeah, time. I'm like, oh wow, okay, you know, yeah.
I was rolling in it, and I'm sure I was working like 70-hour weeks. But anyway, I wouldn't trade that experience for the world, and learned so much there, and still have great friends and relationships from that experience. But anyway, so got the movie in the can, and so in the can, you know, you have everything shot, right?
Yeah.
So it's shot, it's developed, and you're going into post, and you feel like that feels like a Sisyphean experience. Like, I got this done. And so I remember, somebody got us a really good deal on a sound mix, right? And
yeah.
Meanwhile, what is a sound mix, right? So like, I didn't know what a sound mix was.
Exactly.
And there was this great guy, I'm still grateful to, his name's Glenn Morgan. He worked at a place called Sound Deluxe, but I walked into that sound mix, and there was one MasterCard like allocated for post-production, right?
Yeah.
And it was expensive, even though it was a crazy deal, it was really expensive. And I spent so much time on the stupid street sounds on like in the opening scene, like I blew,
right.
I rushed the whole rest of the movie. And I felt like, man, I blew it. And I had to like write that check to MasterCard every month for like, but if you don't think that the next person that hired me, that I was the most prepared guy for that sound mix when I walked in, because I hated writing that check. I'm like,
exactly.
I want to go buy a margarita. I don't want to do this.
I don't want, and you learn instead of just beating yourself up about, which we all do. And I think that's also the next tip that you gave. And I think that's key. And that's worked for me as being a salesperson. Creatives are often, especially writers, especially authors and screenwriters, we're very reclusive. We stay to ourselves. Obviously, I don't fit that mold as much because I was a broadcaster for 10, 20 years.
Yeah.
So I'm out there more. But I know a lot of writers. But guess what? Especially now, the world has changed. We have to sell our own things. I'm not saying, you don't have to be like, I'm fabulous, and all that. But you better know who you are and get in front of the right people. And when you get 10 seconds in an elevator, right? So tell me about your sales pitch. Like how long I talk. Everyone knows me and watches me and listens to me. I am a chatterbox. But I can do a 10-second pitch in an elevator if I have an executive. Bam. I got to have it.
Heck yes. You got to do it. And you got to keep them engaged. And that's your job. Again, one of my great takeaways from reality TV, I was working on a reality show, and it was this thing for VH1 a million years ago. It was called Remaking. And I was listening to this life coach, right? Like talk to one of the celebrities that was on there. And monitoring it. I'm like, man, I really like what this guy is saying. And I was trying to make my first movie at that time. Right. And I'm sorry. That's Dash ringing the bell.
Oh, Dash. No, please. Dash gets to win. That's what we love about the show, you guys. We said it's just super casual and people can just go off. But just so you know, if you're watching, we're going to have these tips too below in the comments. So, and I'm saying this while you're getting ready. We're going to have, if he's kind enough and not too crazy busy, Jeff, you can guys, we all agree he's amazing and there's so much more. And I want him to come on and teach some writing tips because there's so many specific things I want to do with, this show. But I think that's super important is just when you're talking about sales. So go back to your story now. Now, is Dash happy? Wait, is Dash happy?
He's happy. He's rung the bell.
Okay,
he's patrolling. He's patrolling from the balcony. He does an excellent job of that. But basically what the gentleman's name was Tim Furlong. And what Tim told me is like, you gotta be a salesman, right?
Yeah.
You've got to sell this and you've got to sell it quick. Look, Dawn Steele once said a million years ago, like the best pitch she ever heard for a movie was for Flashdance. And somebody just came in and said, it's Rocky Dancing. Right. And
perfect.
Just find out, what it is. And like, boy, did I like, complain to Tim. I'm like, oh my, you know, I want to make creative stuff. I don't know how to sell, right? And like, yeah. I remember after like raising all that money, he looked at me. He's like, you think you're a salesman now? And I was like, yeah. Yes.
Exactly.
Like,
I mean, but think there's any job beneath you. I think is a good tip too. You know, like you said, you were scraping up little chicken bones. You know, I remember working at a basement someplace every weekend with no windows, you know, trying to make money and doing what I needed to do. But that's what I love. And so if someone's watching and maybe wants to go the director route, you mentioned film school, and also you mentioned interning, literally, which I've heard that story so many times. The mailroom is actually a real story. Like, people think that's a movie story when you hear people start in the mailroom. I know somebody, so many presidents of companies now in Hollywood who started in a mailroom pushing that cart. So that's real, right? That's not fake.
Oh yeah, yeah. No, I mean, that's, you know, for this program. But also it's like, look, I loved casting and I wanted to get in, but look, you know, everybody wanted to be in casting. So I had to beg like and pull favors to go work for free. Right?
Exactly.
Like, to just do everything. But I busted, I busted my butt. I went, above and beyond. Like, I like look back at it. And I'm like, oh boy, man, you had some chutzpah. But I'm like, can I make a list? Right? Like, oh, I went ahead and made this. Like, by the way, that time I was typing it on a Selectric typewriter. Right? I'm like, oh, I made this list of a young
Aaron.
But you know what? When I got to that time on the agency and I was answering the phones, I happened to work for an agent that would listen to me. And I was really, ICM was a huge agency.
Yeah.
And I really, you know, knew a lot of the young talent, right? So I could do lists from casting with ICM clients that had all that kind of like next tier of up and comers. So like all that, you know,
it all paid off, right? All of those jobs paid off.
Yeah. So anyway, just even though it seems like, oh my God, it's so late. How am I going to pay my rent? How am I going to do this? Look, I don't know if it's the person sitting next to you. I don't know if it's the experience. I don't know if it's like the giving somebody a little extra kindness when they needed it. Like, and whether it comes back to you or not is beside the point. But in my experience, it's like, those little seeds that you plant, seeds of kindness or hard work or going the extra mile, you know, some of them can't help but sprout and grow, right? And they're going to come back. Karen, I know we glazed over it, but yeah, yes, I did become a salesman, but I think any good salesperson is passionate about what they sell, right? And they're honest about what they're selling. And I never BS'd, right? Like, and unfortunately, you know, in sales, I can't just give comparables on, you know, all the movies that killed it at the box office. They're not all My Big Fat Greek Wedding and How to Lose a Guy in 10 Days. You know, you've got to also show, which is really hard, especially if you're talking to money people, you've got to show the movies that didn't do so well. Right.
Right.
So, but you've got to make up for that with like, here's what I learned and here's why that's not going to happen with ours. Right.
Exactly. And
you just gotta, you know, get it done. And I guess just make sure this is what you really, 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 really want to do, because that will be challenged on a daily basis. Right.
I think that says it so beautifully. And I think when you talk about the kindness, I mean, I came into this industry, even though I was a journalist, for many years, so being telling stories in a different way as a news reporter and a correspondent, and coming into telling the kind of stories that I'm doing now, these creative stories, but the passion that I had. But if you don't have the passion, and I'm the first to tell people, and that's a whole nother TV series, it is rough, you guys. And it's not like you make it. You never make it. I didn't do Christmas Prince, one of the most watched Netflix movies ever. I didn't make it. It was the opposite. What do you got next that's going to exceed? Or what can you do? And so you have to love it and all your heart. And if you do, no one will stop you. I say when one door shuts, you jump through the window. But the key is that I'm learning is surround yourself. It's a tough, Hollywood is tough. Yeah. And surround yourself with people. And Jeff, you're one that I, even though, believe it or not, this is the first time we've met. I feel like I've known you forever, virtually talking.
We've been through it together. Yeah.
We've been through it together. Exactly. And I have this analogy that I think you said it perfectly. Somebody, a Canadian, you know, we shoot a lot of the movies in Canada, said to me, I pick my friends. We all have fabulous friends. But if you have a lifeboat and you only have so many that you can take, who are you going to take? Are you going to take the friend that you love but is a complainer, or the friend that is always the one that, you know, can fix a problem? So who's going to be in my lifeboat? and yeah. you would be in my lifeboat. So
okay, I'll gladly take that position. Can I give you my version of that
yes,
story?
Yes, like, which I love it.
Hands down, and I'm using this line in my next script, but so the best advice I ever got, I'd been in LA maybe 2 weeks. I knew like two people there. One was a great lady. I would say, like, if you know, we're overgeneralizing, kind of a New York Jewish American princess, right?
Yeah.
Like, and she is, and she's driving me, she's showing me the different parts of LA. We were going past Sunset Plaza, and she's like, from here all the way down, you know, like, yeah, it's kind of Euro trashy. And I'm like, just make these over generalizations. And she's like, Jeff, she's like, finding friends in Los Angeles is like going to Lomans. She's like, you pick and pick and pick and pick, and finally you find a blouse and it's got the label cut out, but you can tell it's a Donna Karen. That you keep. All the rest you throw back. And I was like, okay, right? I don't even know if I knew what Lomans was at the time. And then I remember, like, I was there 4 months later. I'm like, oh my God, she is 100% right. There's so much, you know, there are so many, you know, you're reading through all these people and you're like,
exactly. Well, I say the difference is in New York, it's harder to make, even though New York is where I am based and I grew up in LA. So I can say that. But in New York, I say sometimes it's harder to make friends because you got to get through a little bit. I say the snowsuits, you know. In LA, everyone's, oh, I love you. Kiss, kiss, and let's do lunch. But they don't call.
Yeah.
There's no lunch. Where in New York, I'm talking totally generalizations. I have mad friends in LA and I love LA, you know. But I feel like the difference is our world is a tough world. And for the authors watching, the authors that want to adapt and do that, I say, and I'm one that does both. I'm like, it's a blessing for me to write a book because I get to be my own director, talent, everything. I have full control. In a movie, I don't. And that's what makes movies special is collaborations. But I tell people too, that if you're a movie screenwriter and if you think your story that you write it and sell it, it's the biggest shock that it goes through a lot of changes and you are not consulted about those changes, even, you know, some of the top. And so the collaboration. So I think you need to know the industry and know what you're getting into and pick your friends carefully. And be careful. I mean, any industry that's as awesome as telling stories and the privilege that we have to come into people's lives, it's going to be filled just like any industry with tough people. And honestly, that's why I wanted you on our show. And I wanted to introduce you to my listeners because you have so many things I want to bring you back. And I know your time is valuable. So I want to let you go, but I just want to let you have one thing before we wrap. And we know, don't worry, everybody, we'll see Jeff again. If I can, you know, con him and dash to coming back on, but please tell me just kind of a parting ways of, you know, what you want people to know and what you're working on too.
Oh, I guess what do I want people to know? I mean, just follow your passion. You know, if this is something that you want to do, the creative endeavors that you embark upon early in your career, even if they don't have maybe the production value or the learning that you know you have later in life. You never forget them, right? Like, I remember when I made Angel's Baby, that little musical short, like, our goal was single. Like, I'm like, okay, well, I want the audience to be 15 minutes happier after they watch that movie.
Yeah, I love 15 that.
15 minutes happier than they do this job. Well, you know what? Making Christmas Camp, making, My Christmas Love, we're just up now. We just want them to be 2 hours happier, right? Or 90 minutes happier.
I love it.
So it's like, you're just constantly, constantly honing that. And Trouble with Angels is the rom-com that I'm working on. I'm also working on a fraternity comedy, but the current working title is not that Christmassy. It's about a fraternity house called Delta Kappa Sigma, and I will not tell you what the acronym for that is, but And Karen, I hope we get to work on something else together. I'm such a fan of yours. I think you've got just an amazing, amazing knack for cultivating the stories that, that really resonate with people. And the your continued success just keeps showing that over and over again.
Thank you. It means the world to me, especially with your experience. I'm still a newbie in this. My new book is called Christmas Ever After. It's coming out September 29th. Ooh. And you'll appreciate this. Here's my one line. I have high concept for you. High concept, okay. You guys, for listeners, is when you have one or two lines, like you were saying, Rocky Flashdance, right? Mine is Mamma Mia meets The Bachelorette. That's mine. Mamma Mia meets God. The Bachelorette. I knew you'd love it.
Is there a musical? You know I made that Lifetime movie about instead of The Bachelor, and you know I love Mamma Mia.
Oh yeah, I know. I see, guys, I hadn't told him. So it's coming out. The book is coming out September 29th. You know, I already got the screenplay. You know, I'm working on that as well. And I'm working on a feature film that's Christmas and musical. So I can't even tell you the title on that one because it's so high concept. The title tells the whole entire movie. But these projects are close to my heart, and I'm shooting. Well, I say I'm not shooting, but we're in development, as we say. And guys, what that means is we're turning and burning to get ready to hopefully shoot for this Christmas. We'll see, to get it in for this Christmas. So, but you and I are going to work together because I believe in finding good people, and we can do this together. And just with the people, you just said the people in Christmas camp, you brought them over from your last movie. This is how it works. We just have our group of people that we trust. And we have good people, makes good TV and good movies. So thank you from the bottom of my heart for being here today and sharing your tips. And can people find you Instagram, Facebook? Where is there a place people can follow you?
Yes. Unfortunately, I put a lot more time into Dash's Instagram page than my own.
Okay. We can do Dash's too, because I know you're busy.
No. So Dash's is your buddy. Dash is your buddy. Mine is Jeff, J-E-F-F. LA 33. So Jeff, and then acronym for Los Angeles.
Put that on there. And I know most of my people are like, we don't even do that, we're so busy. I'll have all mine on the screen as well. But again, want to thank you for being part of Christmas Karen Behind the Story. And for everybody watching, we're going to have a lot more of actors, directors, just everyone in the industry. We're going to have some authors that have written Hallmark movies, and they got to go on the set. So, you know, I kind of wrote the movie and then the book, we're going to have the other side. So for authors out there, they want to stay tuned with us, and please join us. And I say, continue the journey at my website, which is KarenShaler.com, and hashtag Christmas Karen. And then you'll be able to follow all of this, but happy holidays, Jeff, to you and your family. And I know, Jeff, you celebrate Hanukkah. So we need to talk about that, because there's movies being made now that are Hanukkah and Christmas movies. And I think that's brilliant, because it's the holidays. We want to be inclusive for everybody. Happy Kwanzaa.
Heck yes. Well, you know, I'm a sucker. I'm probably the only guy that celebrates Hanukkah that makes yearly Christmas CDs for, I love the Christmas music. So
I get
the best of both worlds. I make them for all my friends. Yeah. But now CDs are archaic. So I have to figure out how to send
tradition.
Them. Stupid folders. We transfer. Not as romantic.
I know. It's like what we're doing here. You know, I mean, I'm isolating here because of COVID. So I'm by myself. So I created this Christmas magic. And, you know, I think times are changing. And that's what this is about, is connecting. So thanks for connecting with us. And everybody, thanks for watching. And we'll see you soon. Bye, everybody.
All right. Thanks, Karen.